So this is the second of two videos that I produced on the topic finding the pH of alkalis. In this second one I take a look at past paper questions and answers. In the first one I looked at the underlying principles and attempted to develop a strategy for answering these questions, which is represented by the flow diagram in the slide that you're looking at presently here. Up in the top left there, highlighted in yellow, is the equation for the self-ionization of water, forming hydroxonium ions and hydroxide ions. Below it, now highlighted in yellow, is a simpler version of that, where hydrogen ions are used instead of hydroxonium ions. There's the so-called ionic product of water, Kw, which is the product of the concentrations of hydrogen ions and hydroxide ions in water. It is a modified equilibrium constant, so it's for a specific temperature. Now let's look at remind you of the elements of this flow diagram. Now when you're dealing with a weak base such as ammonia or an amine such as methylamine or phenylamine, you have partial dissociation, so you have an equilibrium equation. And you see that B accepts a proton from water to form BH+. The water is behaving as a Bronsted acid, that's to say it's a proton donor. Now the B is a weak base, it dissociates so little that at equilibrium the concentration of B is simply taken as the original concentration of the base. We'll come back to that. In the first video we saw the relationship, or we developed the relationship, that the product of Ka and Kb is in fact Kw, the ionic product of water, which at 25 degrees C, that's 298 K, is 10 to the minus 14, or 1 by 10 to the minus 14. We then took the negative log of both sides of that equation to get pKa plus pKb equals pKw. P therefore stands for the negative log to the base 10. Note that the multiplication sign becomes a plus sign there. And also that pH plus pOH, where pOH is the negative log to the base 10 of the hydroxide ion concentration in the alkaline solution, is also equal to the pKw, which would be 14 at 25 degrees C. So obtaining the concentration of hydroxide ions depends on whether you are dealing with a strong base or a weak base. If it's a strong base, it's relatively easy. The concentration of hydroxide ions can be obtained directly from the concentration of the strong base, since it fully dissociates. However, with a weak base, you need to be given some information to elucidate the extent of dissociation, since it partially dissociates. So that'll be linked, obviously, with the base dissociation constant, Kb. Now, when you get the concentration of hydroxide ions, you can get the concentration of hydrogen ions using that formula there at the top right, which is simply a rearranged version of the ionic product of water. So again, you can see the ionic product of water, a modified equilibrium constant given the symbol Kw, is equal to the product of the concentrations of hydrogen ions and hydroxide ions. And if you modify that, you can find the concentration of hydrogen ions as Kw divided by the concentration of hydroxide ions. And then with the concentration of hydrogen ions, you can get the pH as the negative log of the hydrogen ion concentration. Now there will be questions in the examination papers that require you to go back from pH to the hydrogen ion concentration. Do you know how to do that? Well, this is the inverse log or reverse log, and to get the concentration of hydrogen ions, it's equal to 10 to the power of the negative pH, or 10 to the power of minus the pH value that you've been given. And you'll see examples of that in the questions that follow. So the symbol P in pH stands for the negative log to the base 10, and it's the same in pKa. So to get the Ka from the pKa, same sort of idea, the Ka is 10 to the power of minus the pKa. Same with pKb, the P stands for the negative log to the base 10, so to get the Kb from the pKb is 10 to the power of the minus Kb. And also with pKw, to get, if you were given the pKw, and you won't find any of that in the questions that follow, but if you were, then Kw would be 10 to the power of minus the pKw. So there you have it, the various different formulae and steps that will be required in the following examination questions. And I'd strongly encourage you to pause and have a go at each of these questions before moving on to take a look at my solution. So, what are the units of Kw, the ionic product of water? Let's remind ourselves of the equation for the self-ionization of water. That's the simplified version, remember. There's the equilibrium constant Kc. Now, only about 2 in 1,000,000,000 water molecules have actually dissociated at any point in time. So the concentration of water remains constant. That means you've got two constants in that expression, Kc and the concentration of water. It doesn't make sense to have two different constants, just combine them, which gives us a modified equilibrium constant. We could call it Kc dash. But in fact, because it represents the ionic product of water, let's give it a W, so it's Kw. And that's the derivation of the ionic product of water, if you like. Now, each of those concentrations is expressed as moles per cubic decimeter. So we have the product of moles per cubic decimeter, which gives us moles squared dm to the minus 6. That's the answer. So you simply add the indices. Mole to the minus 1 times mole to the minus 1 is mole to the 2. Dm to the minus 3 times dm to the minus 3 is dm to the minus 6. Sum of the indices. Pause and have a go. 373, well, that's 100 degrees centigrade, 100 Celsius. You see that the ionic product of water, Kw, is no longer 1 by 10 to the minus 14. That's the one thing that does change an equilibrium constant, temperature. So when you raise the temperature from 25 degrees C, room temperature, up to 100 degrees C, you see that the Kw, the ionic product of water, increases from 1 to 5.14 by 10 to the minus 14. So we already know that the concentration of hydrogen ions in pure water, 25 degrees, is 10 to the minus 7. And we can see from the Kw is bigger, which means that the extent of dissociation is greater. So we're going to get a higher concentration of both hydrogen ions and hydroxide ions. They will still be produced in equimolar amounts, but they will both be present in higher concentrations because the dissociation is greater, as we can see from the Kw value. Now, before rearranging the expression for Kw, we can simplify it because the hydrogen ions and hydroxide ions are being produced in equimolar amounts. So that expression for Kw can be changed to read the concentration of hydrogen ions squared. And that, as we see, is 5.14 by 10 to the minus 14. So if we take the square root of that number, we'll get the hydrogen ion concentration. We'll stick those numbers into the calculator. Take the square root. 2.267 by 10 to the minus 7. That's the concentration of hydrogen ions, from which we can now get the pH of the water. pH is the negative log to the base 10 of the hydrogen ion concentration. Okay, so let's take the negative log, and that gives us minus 6.64, so plus 6.64. That's the answer. Pause again and have a go at this question. So this time we've reduced the temperature to 273K, which is 0 degrees centigrade. From what we've seen earlier, lowering the temperature is going to lower the Kw, which means it's going to reduce the extent of dissociation. So we should end up then with a lower concentration of both hydrogen ions and hydroxide ions. Now, on this occasion, we've been given the pH and asked to find the Kw of the pure water at 273K, 0 degrees centigrade. So what are we going to do? How are we going to get the concentration of hydrogen ions? Well, from the pH, you can see from the flow diagram here that we can get the concentration of hydrogen ions as 10 to the power of minus the pH. So that's 10 to the power of minus 7.47. Put that into the calculator. And that, as you see, gives us The hydrogen ion concentration is 3.38 by 10 to the minus 8. Now we can put that into the expression for Kw, which as you see is the concentration of hydrogen ion squared. So that's 3.39 by 10 to the minus 8 squared. So back to the calculator, square that value, and that gives us 1.15 by 10 to the minus 15. That's the value of Kw. So it's fallen from 1.0 by 10 to the minus 14 to a smaller figure, 1.15 by 10 to the minus 15 mole squared dm to the minus 6. And pause again if you haven't answered the second part. Is water chemically neutral at this temperature? And explain your answer. So there's the simplified equation for the dissociation of water. We've established that the hydrogen ions and hydroxide ions are produced in equimolar amounts. Their concentrations are the same, and as a result the water is still neutral. So though the pH is 7.47, it's neutral at that lower temperature. Pause again and have a go at this. You've been given the concentration of the sodium hydroxide as 0.150 mole per cubic decimeter or molar. You've been given the Kw value as well. Now, a little revision here. You'd be aware perhaps that HCl, hydrochloric acid, is referred to as a monobasic acid, while sulfuric acid, H2SO4, is referred to as a dibasic acid. Mono means one and di means two. HCl is a monobasic acid because it produces one mole of hydrogen ions per mole of itself, while sulfuric acid is a dibasic acid because it produces two moles of hydrogen ions per one mole of itself. And likewise, we have a pair of similar terms for bases. Sodium hydroxide could be referred to as a monoacidic base or monoacid base, while calcium hydroxide is a diacid or diacidic base. Same sort of reason, one mole of sodium hydroxide produces one mole of hydroxide ions in solution, while calcium hydroxide, one mole of it produces two moles of hydroxide ions in solution, hence mono and diacid bases. So basic in reference to acid, acid or acidic in reference to bases. So monobasic acid, monoacid base. Back to the question then. Sodium hydroxide, two things that are important about sodium hydroxide. First, it's a strong base, which means it fully dissociates. And secondly, it is a monoacid base. That's to say, one mole of sodium hydroxide produces one mole of hydroxide ions. So given that it's both a strong base, dissociating 100%, and it's a monoacid base, the concentration of hydroxide ions in the solution will be the same as the concentration of the sodium hydroxide itself. So the concentration of hydroxide ions will be 0.150 mole per cubic decimeter or molar. Okay, there are two ways of approaching answering this question. Let me show you both methods. First of all, let's write an expression for Kw. It's the concentration of hydrogen ions times the concentration of hydroxide ions, and we've been given its value as 1 by 10 to the minus 14. Simply 10 to the power of minus 14. And then we can rearrange the equation. The concentration of hydrogen ions is Kw divided by the concentration of hydroxide ions. So that's 10 to the minus 14 over 0.15. And that'll give us the concentration of hydrogen ions present in that alkaline solution. Remember that in pure water, at 25 degrees centigrade, the concentration of hydrogen ions is 10 to the minus 7. When we add the alkali, that pushes the equilibrium to the left and significantly reduces the concentration of hydrogen ions. So it's going to be much smaller than 10 to the minus 7. There you can see, in fact, it's 6.67 by 10 to the minus 14. And from that, we can get the pH as the negative log. And and that gives us a value of 13.18 for the pH of that alkaline solution, 0.15 molar sodium hydroxide. Now we could use the formula here, the bottom left, pH plus pOH equals 14. This is an alternative way of doing it. Remember, pOH is the negative log of the hydroxide ion concentration. So let's rearrange that to get the pH. What would the pH be? It would be 14 minus the pOH. I've taken the pOH from the left side and the right side, in other words, where the pOH is the negative log of the hydroxide ion concentration. So let's work out what that is. We want the negative log of 0.150. And that comes out to be 0.82. Apologies there, I've put in an extra zero. That should say 0.82, not 0.082. But I have subtracted it correctly in the line below. It comes out to be, as in the previous case, 13.18. So 14 minus 0.82 gives a pH of 13.18. Two slightly different methods of getting the answer. You can either use the formula for the ionic product of water, or the formula pH plus pOH equals 14. Pause again and have a go at this question, please. So the temperature this time is 318 K, and the ionic product of water at that temperature is given as 4.02 by 10 to the minus 14. Now, chemists must be good with moles, with reacting mass, with titrations, etc. And I wouldn't be doing this topic justice if I didn't include a question of this type. Pause if you need to and do have a go at the question yourself. But you're adding 2 cubic centimeters of 0.5 molar sodium hydroxide to 998 cubic centimeters of water, which will obviously bring it up to a cubic decimeter. Now you're going to have to work out the number of moles present in 2 cubic centimeters of sodium hydroxide. You can use the formula N equals CV, where C is the concentration and V is the volume in cubic decimeters. So 2 cubic centimeters is 0.002 dm cubed. I've divided that by 1,000. So N equals CV, and that comes out to be 0.001, where N is the number of moles present in that volume of that concentration. So we know the number of moles, and it's made simple by the fact that the total volume it's present in is a cubic decimeter. So not only is that moles, it's actually the concentration of the sodium hydroxide. Recall a few moments ago that sodium hydroxide A is a strong base, which means it fully dissociates, and it's a monoacid base, which means you get the same number or the same concentration of hydroxide ions as the concentration of the sodium hydroxide. So in the flow diagram, we'll take the hydroxide ion concentration and get the concentration of hydrogen ions, and from that then we'll get the pH. So let's do that. We'll need to use that formula, which is the formula for the ionic product of water rearranged, so the concentration of hydrogen ions becomes the subject of the formula. So let's rearrange it then. Concentration of hydrogen ions is Kw divided by the concentration of hydroxide ions, which will be the same as the concentration of the sodium hydroxide in the solution, 0.001. Let's put those figures into the calculator then to get the hydrogen ion concentration. Using the shift log buttons there to get the 10 to the x. If you've got a 10 to the x button on your calculator, it'll make it all that bit easier. What does that give us then? 4.02 by 10 to the power of minus 11. And if we take the negative log of that number, we'll get the pH of the solution. So I just have to hit the log button there, and it's minus by minus gives us a plus, so the pH comes out to be 10.40. You may be aware that the pH of 1.0 mole per cubic decimeter sodium hydroxide is 14. Here we've got a pH of 10.40 because it's a very dilute solution. Solution of concentration 10 to the minus 3 mole per cubic decimeter. Okay, so pause and have a go at this question. You've been given the ionic product of water at 313 K, and your job is to calculate its pH. Reminder of the equation for the dissociation of water, or the self-ionization of water. There's the expression for Kw. Important then to note that the hydrogen ions and hydroxide ions are produced in equimolar amounts, so we can change the expression for Kw to read the concentration of hydrogen ions squared. So to get the concentration of hydrogen ions, we need the square root of Kw, which is the square root of that number given, 2.92 by 10 to the minus 14. And when we have the concentration of hydrogen ions, we'll be able to get the pH as the negative log. So let's see what that gives us. 1.71 by 10 to the minus 7. And all we need to do then is take the negative log of that number to find the pH. So just hit the log button. And again, we've got a minus by a minus as a plus. So it gives us a pH of 6.77. That's the answer. Pause again, have a go at this question. Okay, so this requires a little bit more reasoning. Again, there's the equation for the self-ionization of water, dissociation of water. A reminder of the figures that we had earlier there. At the higher temperature of 313 K, the pH was smaller, lower. So what we can establish here is, if you lower the temperature from 313 K down to 298 K, you see the pH goes up from 6.77 to 7.0. Now when the pH increases, what does that mean about the hydrogen ion concentration? It means that it's less acidic and has therefore a lower concentration of hydrogen ions. And look at the equation there. If you have a lower concentration of hydrogen ions, it means that there must be less dissociation. So let's apply Le Chatelier's principle, which is that a system in a dynamic equilibrium will respond to oppose any external influence. So if you lower the temperature, it will promote the reaction that raises the temperature. Now, we've been informed that lowering the temperature reduces the extent of dissociation, so it's promoting the reverse reaction. So the reverse reaction is the reaction that raises the temperature. It must be exothermic. That means that the forward reaction is endothermic. That's our answer. The dissociation of water must be an endothermic process. So let me give the reasoning. Let's do it the other way around, raising the temperature. We see that raising the temperature lowers the pH, we could say, which means that it, raising the temperature is increasing the concentration of hydrogen ions. So that means raising the temperature must be favouring the forward reaction. By Le Chatelier's principle, we can then elucidate that the forward reaction must lower the temperature and therefore be endothermic. Next question then, pause and have a go. So can you explain why ammonia is very soluble in water? I think it's something like 1 cubic centimeter of water dissolves 1,000 cubic centimeters of ammonia. You may be familiar with the so-called fountain experiment that demonstrates the high solubility of ammonia in water. It's to do with intermolecular forces, forces between the molecules. And there you see both the ammonia and water molecules. The dots represent lone pairs. The type of intermolecular bonding here is, of course, hydrogen bonding, particularly strong type of intermolecular force. Water molecules are held together by hydrogen bonds. Ammonia molecules are held together by hydrogen bonds. This is why they bond well with one another, because they can hydrogen bond with one another. A hydrogen bond is where a hydrogen acts as a bridge between two electronegative atoms, in this case between an N and an O. The hydrogen acts as a bridge between the two electronegative atoms, held to one by a normal covalent bond, and to the other by an electrostatic attraction, a delta plus on the hydrogen, delta minus on the nitrogens and oxygens there. It's an application of the rule of thumb, like dissolves like. You were asked for an equation there for the reaction of ammonia with water. You've seen this before. It is an equilibrium reaction. Ammonia is highly soluble, but a small proportion of the ammonia molecules do this. They deprotonate the water molecule, in other words, they take a hydrogen ion or a proton from the water, as you see. Meanwhile, the electrons in the bond between the H and the O both go on to the oxygen. So what does that produce? Well, it produces NH4 and OH. Now, the NH4 will have a positive charge because the nitrogen agreeing to share its lone pair with the hydrogen is effectively down an electron. The oxygen has a minus charge because it gets both electrons of the HO bond there. And the reason that a solution of ammonia in water is only weakly alkaline is because the equilibrium here lies far to the left hand side. If dissociation had been complete in 1 molar ammonia, then the pH would have indeed been 14. The ammonia is behaving as a Bronsted base because by definition a Bronsted base is a proton acceptor, while the water is behaving as a Bronsted acid. By definition, a Bronsted acid is a proton donor. The green arrows illustrate that happening. And on to the next question then. Pause and have a go. Here we're dealing with potassium hydroxide solution at 25 degrees C, so Kw will be 10 to the minus 14. We've been given the pH, so we'll take the pH and use that formula, concentration of hydrogen ion equals 10 to the power of minus the pH, in order to get the hydrogen ion concentration. We can then rearrange that expression for the ionic product of water to get the concentration of hydroxide ions as the Kw divided by the concentration of hydrogen ions. That'll give us the concentration of hydroxide ions, from which we can get the concentration of the, not sodium hydroxide, but potassium hydroxide. Potassium hydroxide, KOH, is a monoacid strong base, so it'll be straightforward to get the concentration of the KOH when we know the concentration of the OH minus. Okay, so take that pH, first of all, 11.9, and use it to work out the concentration of hydrogen ions. So the concentration of hydrogen ions is equal to 10 to the power of minus the pH, minus 11.9. So we put that into the calculator. Again, I'm having to use the shift log buttons to get the 10 to the x feature. And 10 to the power of minus 11.90 comes out to be 1.26 by 10 to the minus 12. That's the concentration of hydrogen ions in that solution of potassium hydroxide. As you would expect, very much lower than the concentration of hydrogen ions in pure water, 10 to the minus 7. So we've rearranged the expression for Kw. Let's put those values in to get the concentration of hydroxide ions. So Kw at 25 degrees C is 10 to the minus 14. We put in the concentration of hydroxide ions and work that out. The way I would tend to do this kind of fraction would be split it up into 1 over 1.26 and then work out the indices separately. If I bring that 10 to the minus 12 to the top line, I change the sign of the indice to 10 to the plus 12. And 10 to the minus 14 times 10 to the plus 12, we add the indices, and that gives us 10 to the minus 2 overall. So that's 1 divided by 1.26 multiplied by 10 to the power of minus 2 effectively. And that comes out to be 0.79 by 10 to the minus 2, and that gives us the concentration of hydroxide ions is 7.9 by 10 to the minus 3. And because potassium hydroxide is a strong monoacid base, the concentration of the potassium hydroxide is the same as the concentration of hydroxide ions. so 7.9 by 10 to the minus 3 mole per cubic decimeter. That's the answer. Okay, on to the next question then. So, a question in two parts. Can you work out the pH of a solution of potassium hydroxide of concentration 0.016 molar or mole per cubic decimeter? It is at 25 degrees C and you've been given the ionic product of water there, as you expect, 10 to the minus 14. The concentration of potassium hydroxide directly gives us the concentration of hydroxide ions because potassium hydroxide is a strong monoacid base. From that we can use that formula, the ionic product of water, to get the concentration of hydrogen ions, and from that we can get the pH. So pause and have a go if you haven't already done so. So the concentration of hydroxide ions is going to be the same as the concentration of the potassium hydroxide, 0.016 molar. Let's use the formula method, pH plus POH equals 14, just to try it a different way this time, where POH is the negative log of the hydroxide ion concentration. So I've rearranged that equation. So it's going to be, the pH is obtained as 14 minus the negative log of the hydroxide ion concentration. So let's get the negative log of 0.016. As you see, that comes out to be 1.80. So 14 minus 1.80 gives us the pH of the potassium hydroxide solution to be 12.20. Then what about the pH of 0.1 molar potassium chloride? Well, potassium chloride is a salt, so we're talking here about a salt solution. How would you make that salt? What acid would you use? You'd use HCl to introduce the chloride ions and a base. Well, I've made a mistake there. That should of course be KOH. Potassium hydroxide would need to be used there. So it should be KOH. Now, because hydrochloric acid is a strong acid and potassium hydroxide is a strong base, if you've learnt your salt hydrolysis, you'll be aware that a strong acid and a strong alkali produces a neutral salt solution. Those ions in that salt, K plus and Cl minus, have very little tendency to undergo hydration with water. So neither hydrogen ions nor hydroxide ions are produced. The answer? Neutral, pH 7. Now, I did say earlier that I wouldn't do this topic justice unless I brought in significant mole calculations, and this is quite a difficult question, so pause, give it considerable thought, and have a go at it yourself. Take down the key bits of data here. So, you'll have established that your job is to work out the mass M of the potassium hydroxide that has been used to completely neutralize the 755 cubic centimeters of 0.012 molar hydrochloric acid. So there'll be some of that potassium hydroxide left over, and your job will be to work out how much. There are two ways of working out the number of moles of KOH. One will be from the pH of the solution, 11.60, and the other will be from the straightforward fact that moles is mass over the formula mass. So you see that the formula mass is 56, so the number of moles is going to be m over 56. So that m grams of KOH being added represents m over 56 mole. Most of that will react with the HCl. How much HCl have we got in the flask? Well, we've got 755 cubic centimeters, which is 0.755 dm cubed, and its concentration is 0.012 mole per cubic decimeter. There's the equation for the neutralization reaction that's occurring between KOH and HCl to form the salt KCl. We're going to have to work out the number of moles of HCl present. How will we do that? Well, we use the formula N equals CV, where C is the concentration, 0.012, and V is the volume of acid in cubic decimeters, 0.755. So the number of moles of HCl present is 0.00906. You see it up to the right of the flask there. Now look at the balanced equation and you'll see that they react in equimolar amounts, the base and the acid. That means that we will have used up that number of moles of potassium hydroxide in order to neutralize the HCl. So we'll have to work out in a moment how many moles of KOH remains. Separately from the pH, we can work out the hydrogen ion concentration at the end, after neutralization of the acid, as 10 to the power of minus the pH, 10 to the power of minus 11.60, and you can see there it comes out to be 2.51 by 10 to the minus 12. If we rearrange the expression for the ionic product of water, as you see there, we can work out the concentration of hydroxide ions, 10 to the minus 14 over the concentration of hydrogen ions. So it comes out as 0.00398 mole per cubic decimeter. Now, the problem is we're not dealing with a cubic decimeter. We have got less than a cubic decimeter, 0.755. So we have a fraction of that number of moles, simply 755 over 1,000. So let's find out what that fraction of 0.00398 is. That'll give us the actual number of moles present at the end. And comes out as 0.003 moles of potassium hydroxide left over. Now we need to add to that the number of moles of KOH that will have reacted. And that'll be the same as the number of moles of HCl that was present. We worked that out earlier, 0.00906. So if we add those together, the total number of moles that must have been present initially in the m grams of KOH is 0.012 moles. So these two things are related. M over 56 moles is the same as 0.012 moles. So let's work out what m is. M is going to be 0.012 times 56. Comes out to be 0.68 grams. Hope you got that. Quite a difficult question because of the moles involved. Again, pause and have a go at this penultimate question. You've been given the base dissociation constant of the weak base ammonia, which is a measure of the extent of its dissociation. And just as you would use Ka, use Kb in the same way. There's the equation showing how ammonia interacts with water, as we saw earlier. There's the expression for the equilibrium constant Kc. As the concentration of water remains essentially constant, we have two constants in the same expression, so simply multiply them out. That's what gives us the base dissociation constant, which we'll call Kb, simply a modified equilibrium constant. And that ammonia on the bottom line, the concentration of ammonia there, the ammonia is a weak base, it dissociates so little we can take the concentration of the ammonia at equilibrium to be simply the concentration of the ammonia at the start. And the Kb is 1.8 by 10 to the minus 5. So we're going to have to find out, first of all, the concentration of hydroxide ions using this formula. Again, if you look at the equation, you can see that ammonium ions and hydroxide ions are produced in equimolar amounts. So that top line can read concentration of hydroxide ions squared. Concentration of ammonia on the bottom line is 0.15, and that equals the Kw, 1.8 by 10 to the minus 5. So you solve that for the concentration of hydroxide ions. It'll be the square root, as you see, of 0.15 times Kw, and that gives us 2.7 by 10 to the minus 6. That's the concentration of hydroxide ions. We need now the concentration of the hydrogen ions, which we'll get using the expression for the ionic product of water, as you see. We rearrange it. Concentration of hydrogen ions is the Kw divided by the concentration of hydroxide ions, 2.7 by 10 to the minus 6. Again, I would split that to be 1 over 2.7 and then deal with the indices separately. So that gives us 3.7 by 10 to the minus 9 mole per cubic decimeter. And from that, the concentration of hydrogen ions, we can take the negative log and get the pH of the solution. It is a weak base, so we would expect a pH not too far above 7. And that comes out to be 8.43. It is quite a dilute solution, 0.15 mole per cubic decimeter. Now, the concentration of the methylamine is not the same, 0.6, but let's take a look at this. Methylamine is an amine. You can see how it, like ammonia, will form hydrogen bonds with water. So methylamine is also very soluble in water. Now that methyl group, you could consider that to have replaced one of the H's on the ammonia molecule. Well, alkyl groups, in this case a methyl group, they are said to be electron donating. They will donate electrons towards the nitrogen, which makes the nitrogen more prepared to share its lone pair with a proton from the water. So the lone pair is more available, and methylamine as a result is a stronger Bronsted base. So we would expect that to be reflected in a higher pH. Okay, so let's look at the equation for the interaction of methylamine with water. Methylamine will first dissolve in water, but then some of its molecules will react with water, deprotonating some of the water molecules to create that ion, called the methyl ammonium ion, plus hydroxide ions. So there'll be an increase in the concentration of hydroxide ions from the normal 10 to the minus 7. As we did in the previous equation, there's the expression for the base dissociation constant for this particular reaction. Again, highlighted in yellow, you can see the product ions are produced in equimolar amounts. So that top line of the Kb expression can be changed to read concentration of hydroxide ions squared over the concentration of the methylamine. And again, methylamine being a weak base, we can make the approximation that the concentration of the methylamine at equilibrium is the same as its concentration at the start, as given 0.6. So if we do as we did in the previous case, we can work out the concentration of hydroxide ions, taking the square root there, and it comes out as 2.64 by 10 to the minus 4. Again, as we did previously, we can rearrange the expression for the ionic product of water to get the concentration of hydrogen ions. Let's see what that gives us. Again, I'm splitting there that 1 over 2.64 and then dealing with the indices separately. 10 to the minus 14 times 10 to the plus 4 gives 10 to the minus 10. So there's the concentration of hydrogen ions, 3.7 by 10 to the minus 11. And if we take the negative log of that number, we'll get the pH, which we would expect to be higher than in the case of ammonia. Okay, the concentrations are not the same, but I'll address that in a moment. So let's work out what that concentration of hydrogen ions gives us by way of a pH. Recall that the presence of the methyl group, which is electron donating, makes the lone pair on the nitrogen more available, which means that it's a better proton acceptor, creating a higher concentration of hydroxide ions, giving higher pH. And that comes out, as you see there, to be 10.43. Now, if we compare like with like, what would the pH be for 0.6 molar ammonia? Well, the answer is 9.03. So methylamine is a stronger base, reflected in having a higher pH value for a solution of the same concentration of ammonia. So that's it. Hope you find that helpful. And thanks for viewing.